And then sometimes we just coast. We repent, there's no more sin, and so we say, okay, I'm good. I don't gotta do nothing. I guess I'll just wait till Jesus comes back, right? It's easy to get into that mindset. And we're gonna talk about some of the things in this scripture. It says, every valley shall be exalted. Every mountain and hill brought low. The crooked places shall be made straight. You know, those valleys are places like that where we feel like we can just coast. Where we feel like, oh, maybe there's nothing that God wants me to do. You know, I'm saved. I'm okay. I'm praying at home. But, you know, I'm not really getting too active. Some people kind of shy away from the gospel because they have to do too much. There are a lot of Christians, unfortunately, in a lot of churches today that think like that. Every mountain and hill speaks to the challenges that we have to go through in life. Those moments when you don't think you're going to make it. Anybody been through some mountains in here?
Come on.
Some hills? Come on. Some challenges? Some mountains that you just couldn't see over, and maybe you had to rely on God for those things? The crooked places? I can talk again about the sin in our lives, the things that distract us. When God wants us to just walk a straight path, and we get distracted by lust, by pride, and other things that we know we have no business doing. The crooked places and the rough places made smooth. You know, in this portion of the book of Isaiah, the people have been pardoned for their sins. And so we're catching them right there at a moment of repentance. But then you get to verse 3, and it says they're in the wilderness, the voice of one crying in the wilderness. And I was thinking about this thought, and I have this picture here of almost instantly when I thought of the wilderness, I thought of this moment in The Lion King. Can we pull up that picture? You know, with the bones and the, there it is. Anybody recognize this? The outlands, dry bones, devoid of life, some mountains, no greenery. And you know, when we think of the wilderness, this is what we think of, right? This dry land, this rough terrain. But if we go to the next picture, this is a picture of a place in Israel called En Gedi. Beautiful place, right? Beautiful place, waterfalls, look. I had to get the people in there because they're just chilling. They're just relaxing, right? But if you read, but you can go to the next slide too. If you read the Bible, while David was on the run from Saul, it says he wound up in this place called En Gedi. And it's full of life, and it's abundant, and it has flowing rivers and waters. But if you look at it, this is in the middle of the wilderness of Judah. You see, some people are like these people, in church or in their relationship with God, in the middle of the wilderness, just chilling. They have no idea that they're outside of the will of God. They have no idea that they could be doing so much more. But they're just hanging out in the wilderness, thinking. And so I want to talk about God's will. Where is it that he wants us to be? We know it's the church. And why is that? Because Jesus loves his church. We've been talking about end times. We've been talking about Revelation. And if you've heard about the rapture, the second coming of Christ, you know he's coming back for his church. Because he loves his church. And the church, you've heard it before, is where God shows up. There are things that happen in the church on a daily basis that don't happen anywhere else. There are things that we can do in a church that we can't do anywhere else.
Come on.
Things happen here. And God created us for this. The first thing I want to hit on is the relationships in the church. You know, God created us for a relationship. The very first thing that he did said, let us make man in our image. He already had a relationship, us. And he created man for what? A relationship with him. The Bible says he walked with Adam in the garden. He had that relationship. Let me say something. You should value the relationships in this church. This is where God chose to put you, to deal with people, to have fellowship with people, to work through some of those rough places that you're going to have, amen, in relationships. Let me tell you, there's some people in this church, I'd never be talking to them if it wasn't for God. Yeah, yeah. Ah, man. Some of y'all, I'm just playing. No, but seriously, I need Jesus to get me through some days with people in this church. And I'm not the only one. And that's not a bad thing, because that's how God reveals himself. And I thank God for those moments. Luke 14, 26 speaks of hating your mother, father, brother, wife, sister, and even your own life. You know, that doesn't mean you gotta talk off your family members or your friends, but there's a principle there that speaks to the value of the things in the church that come from following Jesus. Do you recognize the value? Do you value relationships in the church over relationships outside the church? You know, be careful. When you're seeking outside counsel, when you feel comfortable, more comfortable coming to people outside the church than you feel about coming to your pastor or pastor's wife or your friends in the church or your church family. Deuteronomy 12:5, God chose you to stay in a place to worship Him. God wants you to seek Him in this place, but you shall seek the place where God, the Lord God, chooses out of all your tribes to put His name for His dwelling place, and there shall you go. Are you seeking God consistently, or are you just kind of showing up? These are real questions that we have to deal with, that I have to deal with every day. The second thing I was thinking about was ministry. He put Adam in the garden for relationship, and He didn't just say, you know, hey man, just chill out here like those people in En-Gedi. Right? I'm sure Adam had all that he could ever dream of, right? Trees, he didn't have to wait for the fruit to ripen. It's already ripe. Clear water, green cut grass. I don't know how God cut the grass, but I bet you that thing was cut and landscaped, right? He could have just been chilling underneath some palm trees the whole time. But God said, no, I want you to tend to this garden. I want you to work. I want you to manage this. I want you to maintain this. And if any of you ever done some landscaping, you know that gardens can grow out of hand pretty quickly. It's a constant thing, right? You have to pay constant attention. That was His ministry. You know, each and every one of us have a ministry here.
Come on.
Hallelujah. The other thing I was thinking about was discipleship. Discipleship.
Come on.
Adam had a wife, and what did God tell him? Be fruitful and multiply. Be fruitful and multiply. Do you have a disciple tonight?
Ooh. Come on. Come on.
Do you have somebody that's looking up to you? Some of y'all don't know that people are watching you every single day. Do you have someone that you can give some insight to? Do you have someone that you can grow in the Lord? Are you multiplying another version of yourself? Can you look at that person and say, hey, just do what I do? Philippians 4:9, Paul told the people, whatever you see and heard in me, do. Right? Just be an exact copy of me and you'll be okay. 1 Corinthians 11:1, follow me as I follow Christ. This is what Paul was saying to the people. Can you say, if you told everyone, just your disciple or someone looking up to you, hey man, just do what I do on a daily basis. From the time you wake up, from the time you go to work, from the time you get back home, from the time you do whatever you do, from the time you get to church, from the time you go to bed, are they going to make it to heaven? If they're just doing exactly what you do, if they spent a week or a month in your shoes, will they make it? That's a question we should ask every day. Discipleship is big in the kingdom of heaven. I want to talk real quickly as I'm closing here. I haven't even looked at the time, but I think I'm all right. Let's talk about the treasure that God has here. This is a treasure. Hallelujah. And if you don't see this as a treasure, you're going to miss the whole point of being here. You got to see this as the best treasure that you have ever found. Matthew 13. Can we put that verse up real quick? Matthew 13, verse 44. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid. And for the joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. So I want you to picture this real quick. This dude, he's walking home, right, on a long journey. He's probably got a staff. He finds that treasure in the middle of nowhere. And instantly makes that decision to go and sell all of his possessions, everything he has, not even thinking about his feelings, the things that he was attached to. He let all of them go because he realized this treasure was better than anything he'd ever come to. Anything else he'd ever find. That's what he was talking about. That's what Jesus was talking about in Luke. Because sometimes our friends and our family, they're gonna tug and pull when our focus really needs to be really needs to be here. Sometimes people are gonna have different opinions. Sometimes people are gonna pull you out of the will of God simply because they want your company or they want your attention. Hallelujah. But you gotta think about what the greatest treasure is. What the best thing is for your life. Because God wants to do something in His church. How is your attitude towards the church tonight? Towards this treasure? You know, God responds to your attitude. God responds to your character. Psalms chapter 18. We're going to read two verses here. Psalms chapter 18. Verse 25, with the merciful, you will show yourself merciful. With the blameless man, you will show yourself blameless. Verse 26, with the pure, you will show yourself pure. And with the devious, you will show yourself shrewd. You know, how we think about God is a reflection of how we think about the church. The people in the church, our relationships, our ministry. Discipleship. Those are like top three. Top three. You see, but it's our job, amen, to prepare the way, as we just read. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. The church here, which should be on the top of your list, amen, the church provides an avenue for God to work in your life, for Him to put something in that others are going to reap.
Come on.
We're not doing this for ourselves.
Right.
You know, some days I wake up and I think about, you know, the task before me, and I get burdened down too. You know, I know we all get like this, but then you got to think, man, this isn't my life anymore. This isn't my life anymore. And I know it's easy for me to say that, you know, I've had a good career, and, you know, I left a lot of things, amen, back in my own life, traveled and seen a few things, so it's easier for me to kind of say, no, I don't need all that. I've experienced a lot of things. Enough for me to say, you know what, I've seen a lot, I'm willing to see what God has. I'm done with that previous life.
Come on.
Can you get there tonight? Can you get to the revelation of what God has for you in this church, the place that it chose, is greater than all those other interests, all those other desires. And when we start to move things out of our life, we got to lock ourselves in. Oh, there's plenty going on here tonight.
Come on.
We're always excited to get to church on a Sunday. At least I am. Sunday morning, Sunday night, hallelujah. Wednesday night, come Monday on. Comes.
Come on.
Tuesday, what are they doing?
Come on.
But you see, when we lock ourselves into these things, it's not extra. God wants us to do that. He wants to respond, and that gives Him a reason to respond. How many want to make God respond in their lives?
Come on.
Because when God responds, it's big. And it's for His glory. The verse says, the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed through you. Through us. Through us. And so what I'm going to leave you with tonight is that we got to put some work in to prepare the way, to make sure we're here. Proverbs 16:1. And so that God can respond, amen, to what we're doing. The preparations of the heart belong to man. It is our job. We've got to put some extra effort in. We've got to say, you know what? I'm done with all the video games. I'm done with hanging out with friends. I'm done with the TV shows. I'm going to put that on the back burner, amen. And I'm going to focus my mind, amen, where God can really use me. Something fruitful, amen, so I can show other people that walk into this place, amen, because their lives are going to be filled with a whole bunch of stuff. And they're going to say, you know what? It's all good. I'm saved. Oh, it's all good. I'm saved. And when the devil comes in, boom, he's going to hit, and he's going to hit hard. And they're not going to know what hit him. The preparations of the heart belong to man, but the answer of the tongue is from the Lord, one of the greatest things in this life is being able to hear from the Lord.
Come on.
But you got to give him something to respond to. You got to give him something to respond to. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes as we're bringing this service to a close. You know, the response of God, you can't take that lightly. We cannot take that lightly. Sometimes we think that we're losing by being here because the world thinks completely different. We think we're at a loss because we let go of some things that we're attached to, that we identify with, our old lifestyle, the old man.
Come on.
But you see, what I just read in Isaiah, this is a scripture that brings comfort. Because you are going to have heart.